They had no gun in the trunk. And the thing went off, shot right through the heart.
Wow.
That was a memory I could never forget.
Wow. That's amazing.
And I don't really remember anything much then until maybe I was 5 or 5 years old.
Wow. But do you remember your dad?
Oh yeah, my dad, sure. We stayed with our dad, me and my brother.
Mm-hmm.
My aunt, too. My sister, soon as my Renabelle, she's a year and 6 months younger than I.
Oh, okay.
And I was a year and 6 months younger than my Ollie, my brother. It was 3 of us.
Oh, okay.
Tell them about the dog that y'all used to have, used to lead y'all away.
A dog?
Yeah, we lived in the rural, in the hills out in the Mississippi, at Macon, Mississippi, Knox County. Some of you call it Neshuba. We called it Knoxubi
County. Oh, okay.
And this grass, you know, we'd bring this straw and make brooms out of it, you know, people in the hills.
Mm-hmm.
And that grass grew about that tall. And in the hills there were snakes they called black snakes. They were not poisonous, they say. But they had, where people walked, they had a little path down in the grass. And we had an old dog. Nobody trained the thing, but he would go with us everywhere we go.
The dog, what was his name?
Dog.
Roscoe.
Roscoe. Roscoe Jenkins.
Roscoe, and he was crippling his hind leg. He hopped on 3 legs.
He hopped on 3 legs.
But that dog, I don't know how he trained himself, really. He would get right in front of us in that little pass. We'd go in from our house over to our aunt's house. And them snakes, black snake, they'd stand up that high and turn their head around, be looking like that.
A snake?
Ooh. Yeah.
Have to look over the grass.
But they wasn't, it's not the sportsman pouring the snake.
Ooh.
But that dog would go right in front of us. And when he'd get up on to the snake be looking around like that. He'd grab that snake by his head and shake him in his mouth like that. And then throw him out there and beat him, killed it, you know.
Wow.
And we stand back and see what the snake's gonna do. The snake just curl up, stop. And the dog get right in front of us and go along right in front of us again.
Wow.
The snake come up, he's gonna grab that snake.
God trained him,
dog. I don't know who. And the Lord's trained him, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
But that dog would take care of us.
Wow.
That is all your life.
That is amazing.
And that's in my prayer. I always say, Lord, you've been blessing me all of my life.
Mm-hmm.
So we've come through.
Mm-hmm.
You're talking about dangers, toils, and snares. I remember when I was quite young, we'd always, and I've always been the dad devil of the bunch.
Mm-hmm.
And we'd come through places in the Castabai in the area, and we'd always get that seine, the lakes, you know, and they pull in the seine. That's a net, you know, got floaters on the top of it, lead line on the bottom, we had to drag the bottom to catch the fish. The thing would get hung. I would dive down and go down under that to try to untangle it.
In the river.
So
you're a good swimmer then, right?
I could do pretty good.
That you can swim now, you want to go to swimming pool today?
She said, you think you can still swim if you try?
We can go to the lake in the morning.
Oh, I've been in the Navy. You had to learn how to swim in the Navy, you know. But I haven't done any swimming in years. But anyway, I went down to untangle the net.
Mm-hmm.
And I got tangled up in the net. And I stayed down there, and nobody knew I was. They waited for me to come up. And I finally got loose.
So you were holding your breath all that time?
I was trying to hold my breath. I was holding my breath and trying to get my toe untied in that net. So I got breath and I came up. And after I came up, I was the daredevil, dived off, went back down there again.
Were you crazy?
I was crazy. Lord took care of me all of that, you know, along those times. Just the Lord.
Wow.
I went back down there and got that thing, had to pull it up, pulling it along. A thing was down there and it had gone way up under there. Then I had to get there and pull it out from under there and then pull it back up over there to get it out.
Wow. Yeah. Wow, yeah, you were a daredevil.
Then you say you went down, you finally got out, you went down again and got stuck again?
No, I didn't get stuck again. I got the net loose by this time.
Wow.
But to go back down after, I almost didn't get out that time. Wait until I got my breath good to go back. Nobody else would do it, so I was doing it.
Wow.
How old were you then?
I was a teenager then.
Wow. Well, how does it feel to be getting closer to 100?
Well, I feel pretty good.
I asked this morning, did he feel old? He don't feel old as I did yesterday.
Wow, that's long.
What was the hardest thing you think you've done, Dad? What was the toughest time you've ever experienced in your life?
Having Chris, what?
The hardest thing I've ever had to get over was when my first wife passed. It was so bad. We were at church in Shelby, but she passed. And to come home and tell the children that mother had passed was the hardest thing for me. It was so bad. I had to come back home by myself and call the ambulance to pick her up.
So nobody would ride with you to come back?
Well, nobody would come back with us. She and I went down there together. The ambulance picked her up, then I'd drive back by myself. I drove up in the yard, and it looked like my heart was going to just stop because I dread coming in the house telling the children your mother is dead.
Wow.
And I just passed out. I grew up in the yard and passed out. My sister Rita Bell had to be there. She came out. They had called, you know, and she was there. And she was out there trying. But that was tough. For a week I couldn't eat. That was an awful experience.
What was one of the most exciting or happiest times of your life?
When I was born.
When I was born. Still my life.
I didn't get that.
I asked one of the best things, most happy times of your life, Yolanda said when she was born.
Well, the best thing that happened to me was after wife had passed and Sheila was
seven-month-old
baby, and I didn't know what to do with all these children and a 7-month-old baby. I didn't know what to do. And every time somebody told me that I need to get me a wife, and I would hate them for that. I remember one of the members of the church, mother of the church, Sister Liddell, called me, and I thought she was an insult to me. She said, "Brother Dixon, let me tell you something. You've got that little baby. You need somebody to help you." And I said, "This woman's..."
She's crazy.
But the Lord bless me. How am I going to, you know, face up to somebody to tell them to marry me with all these children? I couldn't do that. So when I did get the courage to, I believe it was Superintendent Howard, he said, "Dixon, why don't you try Sister Irene? She ain't got no husband. She might consider marrying." So I thought, and I said, "Maybe I will." So I said, I wrote me a little letter.
Did you try that, Chris?
She didn't answer for a while. And I got so afraid then, I said, "This woman is laughing me to scorn. I hate to go out now because she done told somebody, that man with all those children, asking me to marry him. And she's making me laugh and stuff, and I was ashamed, but I didn't know who she had told me." Because after a while, you know, after I didn't get any letter, you know. So finally, a letter came.
Uh-oh.
And man, a letter came. She said, "I'll be glad to consider it." And
wow. Man,
that is one of the best news I heard. Oh, brother, the Lord. The
Lord has answered your prayer.
After all. And I was a good wife, loved the children. And that was the best thing could ever happen to me. So all during the time, the Lord has always made a way for me. In fact, he was the way, and he is the way.
Well, what age were you when you got saved?
Hey, how are y'all doing? Sister Ella? How are you?
All right.
Come on, Mitch, how you doing?
Just about to get...
Surprise. Just about to leave.
I just came to say hi.
No, y'all get something to eat.
What age were you when you got saved? What age were you when you got saved?
Oh, I was about 20. Yeah. I got saved when I was in the Navy. I was on one of the islands in Hawaii.
He saw that water. He said, "Lord, this."
Well, I learned how to swim. I was at Great Lake, Illinois, where it was a Navy base. And in the Navy, you got to learn how to swim. And they would carry you up on something, maybe tallest up there, that ceiling. You go up a thing and it marked just in a drill. When you get to the end of that, you just step off.
You step off whether you could swim or not?
Whether you could swim or not.
You just step off in the water.
They had an expert swimmer, you know, lifeguard. They would pick you up. But some of the fellas, they walk out and they say, I can't jump over. Yeah, you got to get off.
It sound like quit.
Say, somebody push me off. No, ain't nobody going to push you.
And you just have to jump off.
You got
to
move. Up, two, one, two, three. Boom, down in the water.
And then what if you start like you're going to drown or something? Then what happens?
They had to take care of you.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. No problem. Wow. But I was just hankering to get off because I knew how to swim.
Oh, okay.
It didn't bother me at all.
Wow.
And they wouldn't let me go back no more.
Wow.
So,
what else?
Things have happened. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Tell about the guy that tried to say you're gonna try to fight you.
Yeah. Oh, after I got saved, I'd reared up in the Methodist Church. But after I got saved, I just joined because my people were Methodist, you know, and they sprinkled you. But after I got saved, I started trying to teach, you know, after I learned, and I started trying to teach. We had a little place where we was teaching. A man was in there, he's from Louisiana. On the ship, when I was really converted, was on the ship. And when the sun go down, it looked like the moon go, the sun go down under the water. Mm-hmm. When the moon rise, I go down, looking like it just come up, you see the moon, look like it's sticking up out of the water and it come up. That's where it was, that's all you saw.
I bet that was pretty though.
All you saw was the sea and the sky. So, but when we got over there, then I was converted. I got baptized there on the beach, and we started these things. But I was kind of mean, like, you know, and during in boot camp, when you get, you know, want to fight your company, everybody was going to get punished. But one fella got in trouble, and I would get in trouble because I'd be wanting to fight, you know. And they grab you, man, hold you, you ain't gonna get us in trouble. So, but after I got saved, I you know, well, I know I can't be doing this. Fella, one night he came out at night at 12 o'clock, and during those times we're having dinner at 12 o'clock, it's like dinner in the daytime. So, 12 o'clock at night. So I went up to the mess hall that night, and this fella got drunk, supposedly. I'm trying to teach, you know, trying to teach the Bible. Man. He saw me, he came up to me acting drunk, you know. He said, hey, man. I said, go on, fella. You're drunk, so I don't want to fool with you. Oh, you think yourself somebody, huh? I said, fella, go on, lad. Oh, you know, you think yourself somebody. I'll do something to you. So the people come and got him and carried him on the way. So this young man from Texas, he was saved when he got in there. So he said, come on, Brother Dixon, let's go on to the barracks. Well, this guy was right in the barracks with us. We were living in the same barracks. I didn't know he lived in that, but I found out he lived there. But as long as Leo Edwards.
You still remember his name?
I remember his name.
Wow.
So Leo was telling me this is the devil's work and he was trying to get you involved. So don't pay him no attention. I felt pretty good as long as Leo was with me. So Leo lived in another barracks. And when Leo, we came on back and Leo went on to his barracks and I came back and I got in my bunk. And the devil told me, he said, that fella, he mistreated you. Right there before all them guys, and if you don't do something to it, you're a coward, you know. So I reached on the bunk and got my little jungle axe.
Uh-oh.
And looked at it. And said, now when he come in the door, just chop him down.
Wow.
And that, you know, that bothered me. I was trying to go to sleep. But so after I got down and I prayed that night and asked the Lord to bless, and I fell off to sleep. Well, I woke up, but you know, I didn't have that. The devil wasn't talking. I done overcome that. The Lord has brought me through that. And this fella, every time he would see me, instead of coming toward me, he turned and go the other way. Mm-hmm. And I'd speak to him anyway, you know. So finally he came to me and said, Brother Dixon said, I don't know why the devil made me bother you. So I know you didn't bother nobody. You're trying to teach Bible and everything. I don't know why I did that. Said, will you forgive me? I said, oh man, I done forgive you all the time. You've been forgiven. So I brought me that. But the devil sure did talk to me.
See, he was like Jesus. He was tempted. Taking up on a pinnacle.
Do you remember that day about the doing civil rights time? You remember a lot about this era when civil rights time, Martin Luther King, things like that?
Oh, yeah, during the civil rights era. They waiting for us to get out of here?
Oh, no, sir.
She's just checking.
She is checking on
us. Check to see if y'all want something. Yeah, during that era, you know, gang up, four or five people gang up talking. That was during the 59, 60s, and all during that period. When I first came out of the Navy, I went to Tacoma County Courthouse. They told us, now, when you get home, you can go and register to vote. They talked about that. Latter 50s and latter 40s, I mean. And I came back and I went there to the courthouse. And so the lady, I said, I want to register. I'm a veteran, and they told us when we go home to register. Register for what? I said, so I can vote. You know, back then, they only had to pay a poll tax, what they call it.
Mm-hmm.
And so the woman changed color. She just come just shaking, you know.
Good Lord. She was that upset.
Ain't nobody to vote for. Ain't got nothing going on. I said, lady, will you let me register, please? She put your name on that. I went on. And then they said, you can't register unless you learn the Constitution of Mississippi. They wanted you to, I believe it was a 13th Amendment, they wanted you to recite that.
Before you register to vote?
Before you could vote. In other words, a lawyer couldn't pass that thing there. The book was about that thick. Me and my brother-in-law bought a book together.
Good Lord.
Will it be, you know?
Yes, sir.
We bought one of them thick books, Constitution of Mississippi.
Knowing the folks couldn't read a lot of
them. No, they just, you know.
Something to stop.
It's something to stop.
So, when after you get saved, you're always mindful of the fact you try to be peaceful. So I was working on a job with this man, this white man. He was working on that job with us. And he would start to talk. And during this time, Martin Luther King was making his speeches and going to get people registered. So I was a member of the Voters League at the time. We would meet and talk about it. So he would get there in the shop and he started talking. So now what they need to do is go ahead on right now and kill that old brother that's here, you know, Robert Kennedy. Kill him. And that Martin Luther King, well, that kind of upset me. Working on like I wasn't paying no attention. He just kept on. Anybody, he'll run for president too. And if you get rid of him, they'll need to go and kill him too.
Mm-hmm.
At that time, you know, I said, he said, anybody that vote for either one of them, this Robert, Kennedy, Martin Luther King, he cursed and said what kind of fool they were. He just kept on and kind of got under my skin a little bit. So I said, let me tell you something. If either one of them run, I'm going to vote for them. You said if we vote for them, the kind of fool we'd be. I said, brother, if I didn't vote for them, I would be a fool for somebody trying to get some rights for me. I said, this man that come, Bilbo, Theodore Gilmore Bilbo, who was once the governor of Mississippi, he's running for Congress now. And he come on the steps of Cahoma County Courthouse, and they're broadcasting on the radio. He get up, send me back to Washington. If you don't send me back to Washington, if you send me back, I'll send all these niggas back to Africa.
Oh.
I mean, that was, he just blew that over the air. That was a, I told the man that, I said, now, I heard all that. Said, I'll send all them back, because if you don't send them back, there, one day you say it was true. He said, if you don't send them back there, they're going to be marrying your daughters. The guy was right there. I said, but if I've got to listen to all that kind of stuff, who would vote for those kind of folk? No one, but I said, no, I wouldn't vote like one person who talked like that. I said, but if Robert Kennedy run or Martin Luther King, I'm going to vote for him. He pulled off his hat and threw it down. Stood there, looked at me, started scratching his head. He said, you know one thing, Walter said, you know, I understand what you say, but he cooled down. He didn't say no more about that. So showing up, they killed Martin Luther King, they killed Robert Kennedy. But after all his talking, you know, I was trying to be in keeping with what the Lord said, to love the enemy. He took cancer in his lung cancer. He got sick, and then they cut him off welfare, what he's getting. My boss man, along for a while, he gave him sad, but he finally cut him off. And his wife, he told me, said his wife told him, said, if Martin Luther King, anybody, I'm going to vote for him. These folks, what they doing to me, they ain't giving me nothing. And I'll vote for him, his wife. And I would give him money. I had started pastoring then, a little church, and I would give him money, give his wife some money to help him out. So he died.
Mm-hmm.
And but you learn a lot when you go through things. You have a reason to hate people. You have reason to do them harm, but you know, the Lord fix all those things. And I've come through. So I've seen it happen. So I'm convinced, I don't know how long the Lord gonna let me be around, but I remember all the Lord saying, life is really a process. And during a process, you come through many different phases of life. If you live long enough, you go through a lot of phases of life where you have a legitimate reason, you think, to do some things which is not the will of God, but you learn how to try to be in keeping with whatever the Lord said. And the Lord take care of the rest that has been. So I'm doing pretty good. The Lord has given me. I'm by myself. And then when I think I was not by myself, you know, that song we sing all the time, he's with me always. Yeah. Mm. Company keeper.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, man, so 97 years old.
I'm happy with Jesus alone.
More than enough.
Wow.
One of the outstanding presiding bishops who's dead, his wife came down to Clarksdale. She heard that I was alone. Alone. Lord, and she came down. She came down. I done told the Lord, you know, Lord, rest of my life. I'm gonna rest my life to you. So she came down, and I didn't know. I thought she was coming down about some program they were gonna use. Bishop got a some kind of a program, something, you know. They said, I thought that's what Evelyn told me, that she thought that's what she. Yeah. So she came down. And so she came down, and I thought that's what she was about. So she said, Daddy, she want to talk to you. So she didn't know back. No, she said that she was looking for. So they told me, said, child, you will never get cigarettes. I said, no. So I knew what she was about. I said, sister, I promised the Lord the rest of my life. I said, from now on, I'm living for the Lord. I said, I'm not going to be like my brother. One of my brothers, he was 90-something, and he married again. He married that evening about 3 o'clock. Saturday evening. And Sunday morning, at 3 o'clock Sunday morning, he was dead.
Oh, you talking about Brother Warman?
Yeah. So I said, that was one of the deacons in the church, J. James Hill. So I told the lady, I said, I'm going to live for the Lord. Long as I can get along, I learn how to cook a little bit, you know. I get up every morning if I want to and fix me a couple of eggs and bake me some biscuits and get me some honey and sock honey for syrup. Shake so bad sometimes.
But what did you tell the lady?
So I told the lady, I said, I'm not gonna let y'all kill me.
she was on a stick, wasn't she, Dad? Didn't she have a stick?
Yes, she was on a stick.
But she forgot she had the stick, didn't she?
And a stick fell, and I stooped down, picked the stick up, and gave it to her. And when I told the lady, I said, I ain't gonna let none of y'all kill me. The only Lord let me live, I'm gonna live for you.
And what did she say?
She disappeared. I don't know what happened.
How much money?
It's good to see him.
All right, can you drive safe? Tell Millicent we said hi.
All right, thank you.
Thursday.
Let me know.
Thank you.
Tell Millicent we said hello.
I will. Okay. Y'all take care.
All right. So.
See that, Daddy? You could have had another one.
Huh?
You could have had a woman.
I could have had a woman. Not the people at the church. People at the church. One of the sisters got at the church and said, I don't know who gave her that idea at one of my churches. Said, the sisters said, I passed and he got no wife. And said, but what the sisters don't know, he got to come by us.
Uh-oh.
Oh. Yeah, the sister.
Who told her that?
They come by.
They try to take
it. Yeah. But I'm doing fine. Yeah. Well, when you get as old as I am, you start to thinking, what if this, what if that? But the Lord is always, it comes on time. But one thing about it, I've made my peace with God, and whatever he does, I'm just telling him thank you. And it is he that saved, and he's the one going to judge, and I want to stay in good with the Lord. And whatever happens. So if he let me live to get 100, I'd be around y'all.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Some of y'all may get tired of fooling with the old man, but I'm
not. We just hope.
No.
Like insurance now, when you get a certain age, you know, they are skeptical about insurance. And back last year, I had a letter that somebody in the house with me, you know, I had to put them on. That's his wife passed, you know. I haven't put nobody on me. And that's going to be, I'm by myself. I ain't got nobody in the house with me. But I got my license, and they already paid up till they're 20.
I think it's 2021.
And then when you get to think about the older you are, if you get a little bit faint-headed, you know, you start thinking, well, whatever, whatever. But when you're young and a little thing like that happen, you don't pay no attention when you get a certain age. But I thank God for all my children. I feel good about even Wayne and his trouble. Him and his wife, they just as close by. They call, and Atlanta's over there, I call her. Chris is out there, I call him. Walter's over there, I call him. And my renter told me, if you want to go somewhere, just call me, I'll drive you.
Who said that?
Brian.
Oh, okay.
My renter. So I'm blessed of the Lord. As long as I can stay around, I think about giving up everything. But as long as I can be around and tell somebody about the Lord, I feel I'm going to do the best I can with that. Encourage somebody on the way. Tell somebody that life is a process. Along the way, you go through some problems, but if you hang on to the Lord, He'll take you. All of that is important. All right.
Y'all have any more questions?
Thank you all for these, sir. But you didn't have to do it, you know. Some people give you presents.
Yeah, you two more.
I have stuff at the house. I probably haven't looked at you. So,
hold it right there. Hold it.
That one's back there.
And this is what Dr. Taylor sent you from the college. So you can wear a jacket. It's like a home community college, and people think you work there.
Yeah, I got stuff in the house. Dr. Tanner sent me all kind of stuff.
I got to get to that.
Yeah.
And then he sent you a hat to go with it.
Yeah.
Oh, that's nice.
Then he said you come on.
Yeah, I'm looking at what he's saying. Yeah.
So appreciate y'all.
You're welcome.
I got so many calls today. I like to get in the bathtub and steep in the good hot water, you know. And they always had a telephone call. So many people called.
Be careful there.
I'm in the bathtub. Oh, all right.
That's a good idea. That's a good idea.
Is there anything that you still want to do, that you still have a vision for completing?
Not necessarily. So one thing, as long as I can, and that is to witness for the Lord. You know, I give up all aspirations about aspiring to this or that. My concern now, if you just allow me, because I owe him. I'm really in debt to the Lord, and as long as I can, he allow me to do that, whether great or small. One thing I know about God, he is just. And the Lord doesn't require of you that is above your abilities to do. And as long as I can do something for the Lord, he don't have to do anything more for me. Just let things continue as they are. That's good enough for me. And that is happy. I'm not trying to make no name for myself. It's his name is what I'm concerned about.
You never thought you'd get to see a black man be president, did you?
Yeah, I was thinking that too.
No, I didn't.
You didn't win twice.
Ellen.
Yep.
Yeah, that was the thing that I always thought, in fact, knew that if it ever happened, the Lord would be a part of it, would be the reason. Because, and after he was the president the first term, I didn't think he was going to get the second term, and he got the second term. But I told my son that the man that's in there now, he said, oh, he can't win. And I said, I believe you will win. I'm way back for him. Because the company that, you know, the party that was in, they'll do anything. They would deny themselves again and again, because whatever they take, thing they didn't like, they don't like this man and that. But they had to get back in power again, I said. And you watch, he's going to win no matter what. So that happened. But we're not worried about who's who. But I'm satisfied in knowing who God is. That's the important thing.
What makes you want to keep going when you feel tired? What's the thing that you think about that pushes you along?
Oh, my strength is the spiritual side. Jesus. You see, the very fact you are more than people see of you. There's a spiritual part of you, and the natural part. The natural is wearing down, just as the Bible said. But the spirit man is being renewed day by day. Because the spirit man is coming to reality, and the physical man is diminishing. So there are times when you feel like you're going to stay in the bed. About, I never have taken a nap in the daytime. I know I don't sleep in the daytime. And when I get up, I don't go back taking a nap. But I'm going to feel it so, you know, you need to take a nap. And once you get used to laying down, your bed takes the strength from you. And you get it. So sometimes I get up before I eat, I go and maybe study or read or have a prayer until 9 or 10 o'clock before he takes my breakfast. But that's one thing, you've got to push yourself. Because the body wants to go and take that rest. And And Lord, when you get used to laying down and taking that rest, don't lose resistance. So when you start doing that, so that's the thing that drives on and brings you strength. I don't care how late I stay up. I usually wake up and around 4 or 5 o'clock. And most time I get up and I go and have prayer. And sometime I lay back down, you know, after a good while. When I lay back down, I may sleep. But then when I get up, I don't be getting back. Going back, taking a nap. That's it until night again. But it keeps me going. And that's what I'm about.
Y'all get a picture.
And you got pretty good health. And that's, like I say in the song, when you leave, he's good. All right. Like that, because whatever I have done, the Lord has done it. And everything that happened to me that's good, who did it?
God did it.
Oh, yes, so. I owe it. I'm in debt to it. And my prayer is just let me stick around as long as I can to try to pay you because I owe you. Yeah. Y'all gonna leave anything?